हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू रीड जेम्स शिरले'स फेमस पोएम डेथ द लेवलर। एज वी आर रीडिंग पोइट्स पेन पोइट्री, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी हैव रेड ऑल द वर्ल्ड इज अ स्टेज व्हिच इज रिटन बाय विलियम शेक्सपियर एंड दिस दैट पोएम वाज टेकन फ्रॉम एज यू लाइक इट द फेमस कॉमेडी एंड रोमांटिक प्ले, कॉमिक एंड रोमांटिक प्ले रिटन बाय शेक्सपियर। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू रीड अबाउट जेम्स शिरले'स फेमस पोएम डेथ द लेवलर। Death means the death code is the leveler. He levels everything. Mr. Shirley was born in 1596 and was died in 1660. He was a famous English poet and a teacher. The poem. This poem is a dirge. Dirge means just like a sad song, we can say a dirge, just as an elegy. No man can escape death. This is the philosophy of all, most of all religion all over the world, that the death is the most powerful element in this world. No man can escape death. When death came, you cannot defend her, you cannot escape from it. King or farmer, powerful or weak, all men must die one day. King, who is known as the most powerful person on earth, cannot escape from the death. And the farmer also, who is called the survivor of all the humanity. Powerful or weak, a person who is powerful and the other is weak, all are same in the eyes of death. Death put his icy hand. Death puts his icy hand on all men equally. There is no partiality in the eyes of death. In the eyes of death, all men are equal. All the glory and fame has no meaning. You have gained many galleries, many glories, degrees, and many education, and the famous popularity. All are similar in the eyes of death. There is no partiality in it. So we can say the poem suggests us that the pride of our life and the popularity of our life is has nothing in the when we go face to face to the death. Death sees us all equally. We have no armor to defend ourselves when death came. When death puts his icy hand on a person, the person has no armor against death. He cannot remove the death, or he cannot escape from the death, because there is no armor, there is no weapon to defend ourselves from the death. Death must come. This is the gist of this poem, which is written by J.S. Shirley. And death is called the leveler. As a farmer in his field level the earth, the death level all the men with his hand. Death strike equally to king and farmer. There is no partiality. A king who has a scepter in his hand and ruled all over the earth or kingdom of his, and most powerful person in his kingdom, and the farmer who survived the humanity, they are both same in the eyes of death. Death strikes equally to both of them. They both die equally. The soldier is a farmer, and the soldier reaps the head of enemy as the farmer reaps the grain. Here, soldiers and farmers are compared. The poet used simply, as the farmer reaps the grain, as the farmer reaps his grain in his field, the soldier reaps the heads of the enemy. So we can say that both are similar in the eyes of death, and death is compared to the farmer and the soldier. As soldier cuts the head of enemy and the farmer cuts his grain, as well as the death cuts every person. The soldier gain fame and laurel, but they also have to die. We can say the most patriotic person of a country is a soldier. But although he gain fame and laurel is a kind of tree which represents the famous, the fame. And the crown of laurel tree is given to the person who is very brave in his behavior, or who is very brave in his representative to the country. But they also have to die. all the soldiers, all the kings, and all the farmers, poor, rich, wealthy, powerful, weak, every person have to die. There is no weapon to defend ourselves from the hands of death. Death puts his icy hand on each person. Means we have to die because we are mortal beings on this earth. On this earth, every creature, every human being, every person, insect, reptiles, every creature have to die because all are mortal. And we, the person is, we the man on this earth are also the mortal beings. We are not immortal because our body is the made of five elements, which is called earth, water, sky, air, etc. So we have to die. This is the reality. And poet want to say that death is the leveler who makes this work. So we have nothing to proud. There is nothing on earth we can proud. Someone proud on his fields, someone proud on his daughters and sons, someone proud on his wealthiness, on his property, on his money. Many other reasons are there of proudness. But when death came, all proud vanished at once. We have nothing to proud on this earth. This is a reality. And this poem, we can say, is a philosophical element that there is nothing to be proud because death levels everything. Maybe a farmer, maybe a king, all are leveled by the death and all have to go to the graveyard and they are digged and they are graved in the graveyard. Only noble deeds will live on after a man's death. This is the gist of the poem, that there is nothing who will remain after the death of a man, but the good deeds or noble deeds will live on earth after a man's death. Because a man is remembered about his good works, his good deeds, or his noble works. So we can say that we have nothing to proud on this earth, only the good deeds. So be happy and be good. This is the message of this poem, that the death level all the persons similarly, but we have only one thing which is not similar, and that is the good deeds and bad deeds. If a person behaves good with the other persons, means the ancestors of that people remember him as a good person, and this lives. As we know, most of our avatars, most of our gods, and most of our honorable persons are always a good person. As we can say, Mahatma Gandhi, Vivekananda, Ram, Krishna, Isa Masih, Muhammad Sahab, all are the good persons. They do good things, or they did good things, noble things on this earth, and they are remembered till now. Because they know that nothing is to be proud on this earth, only good deeds are permanent. The poem advises us to take pride in doing good rather than in conquest. Sikandar, who conquered most of the Asia, has nothing to be established because there is no quality in him. We know him as an intruder, we know him as a warrior, but we don't know him as a good man or a noble person. Death put his icy hand on the Sikandar also, so we can say that no powerful person can live for a long time because death make equal to everyone. The poem describes the futility of pride in conquest of power. The poem describes the futility of pride. We do not need to pride on anything. In conquest or power, nothing. Technique of this poem. The poet uses of simile, metaphor and rhyme. There are rhyme scheme in the poetry, in the poem, state, fate, things and kings, first line matched to the third line and the second line matched to the fourth line in a rhyme. And there are many metaphors and similes also used in this poem. The glory of our blood and state as shadows, not substance, things, there is no armor against fate. Death lays his icy hand on kings, scepter or crown must tremble down and in the dust of be equal made with the poor, crooked, scythe and spade. These are the opening lines of this poem. These shows that we have no armor against faith and we have nothing to pride. We have only one thing, and that is the noble behavior of ourselves with the other person. And with these words, the poet starts his poem, and at last he says that and advises us that we have not take pride in doing good. We have nothing to take pride, only good rather than in conquest. Only good things we can proud, and not to the conquests. So the poem gives us a great advice that we have to do good with others, and we have to noble works for others. Now the next poem is Essay on Man. As the title suggests, essay. The essay on man, this is a poem, not an essay. And that essay in the verse, we can say it is an essay on verse in poetry. It is written by Alexander Pope, who was born in 1688 and died 1744. He also was an English poet, and he is known as the great poet in English literature. His hyperbole, he is used to hyperboles. His poem, his big poem, or we can say epic, The Rape of the Lock, is very famous in literary world. This is a simple story, but he expressed the story in exaggerated sentences. Essay on Man. This is a simple poem. This poem is a part of longer philosophical poem. As we can see, the title Essay on Man means the qualities of man, or the what is the existence of man on this earth. So we can say the poem is a philosophical poem. It has a message. This is in your syllabus. The first is in your syllabus is Essay on Man. And the second is related to human reason, the power of thinking, and the art and science. All the arts and all the science are included on the second portion of this essay. First part of the essay is taken or is extract on your syllabus. The third is related to science of politics. It is related to science of politics, which is day-to-day used on these days. And the fourth book is related to private ethics. Ethics means the moral things or moral behavior, or behavior to the society must be good. So we can say these all the four parts of the poem cover all the arts and the science of day-to-day world and day-to-day education. And the first part of this poem is on our syllabus. The first two lines are, all are but part of one splendorous whole. The first line shows that all of us, the all person or all man on this world is belong to a supernatural being which is called Paramatma or the super spirit. We are all came from him and will go on him. So we can say this is a philosophical poem which is related to mythological scriptures. The second line, whose body nature is and God the soul. The body of the Paramatma is nature and his soul is God. This is in our syllabus, and now we see that important lines or gist of the poem or the summary of the poem. All the creatures on this earth are part of the great spirit. The great spirit is called Paramatma. All the atmas are related to Paramatma. It is an old philosophy all over the world or in India. All the creatures on this earth are part of great spirit. All the creatures, to little insect, to the human being, and all the animals and the birds, all are the part of one, the great spirit, Paramatma. Nature is body and God is soul. This is the second line of the poem. The body is the nature and soul is God. God is a part of each thing. As we have read in our scriptures, that God is a part of each thing. There is a God in the insect. There is a God in the snake. There is a God in the tiger. There is a God in the man. There is a God in the elephant. And there is a God in the mountains, rivers, and etc., etc. Though in a difficult shape, or different shape, not a difficult, it is a different shape. God dwells in them in different type of shape. As goldsmith make different type of jewels with a gold, the God is also existed in every human being or every non-human beings all around the world. It is the great spirit विच गिव द सन इट्स हीट, परमात्मा हु गिव द हीट टू द सन ऑल्सो एंड द ब्रीज इट्स कूल रिफ्रेशमेंट, इट गिव्स द कूल रिफ्रेशमेंट टू द ब्रीज. इट इज द लाइट इन द स्टार, इट मीन्स द परमात्मा द सुपर ग्रेटेस्ट स्पिरिट. इट इज द लाइट इन स्टार्स, इट गिव्स लाइट टू द स्टार्स एंड द फ्रेग्रेंट फ्लावर इन द ट्रीज. Flower blossom with the help of this spirit or this great spirit on the trees, it remains undivided. The Paramatma is never divided by anything because it is undivided, and Atma and Paramatma are called the same. Its energy remains unspent. Paramatma and Atma's energy never spent. As in said in Gita, Nenam Chiddanti Sastrani, Nenam Dahati Pavaka. Means no one can kill it, no one can be said, no one can kill it, no one can damage it, no one can mind it. Means it is a perfect thing which is not shaped, not killed, or not again birth. It is always remain as the power, as electric, as the part of Paramatma. It remains undivided. It is always same, and its energy remain unspent. Because the power can be spent, but the power of Atma or power of the spirit cannot be spent anywhere. So we can say, Essay on Man is a great poem of Alexander Pope. Alexander Pope, who was a son of London merchant and wrote many famous poems, as I have said, The Rape of the Lock. And in this poem, Essay on Man, there is an irregular rhyme scheme, whole, soul, the two lines couplet are there, and the same fame, breeze, trees, extent, unspent, part, heart, mounds, barns, small, all, means there are the couplets in this poem, which first line rhyme to the second, and third rhyme to the fourth, and fifth to sixth, and seventh to eighth. There are two line couplets. Couplet is a form of verse which has two lines. First line rhyme with the second lines. Mostly, Shakespeare uses couplets in his sonnets as the last two lines, 13th and 14th line. Technique of this poem. Pope uses the rhymed couplet in the iambic pentameter. Iambic pentameter means there is a meter who has the penta, means five parts of iambic meter. And it is in a form of couplet. Iambic pentameter is a famous technique which is used by the Elizabethan period, which is used in the Elizabethan period and the classical age, and in the Romantic age also. The mostly blank verse are used in Elizabeth, as well as the iambic pentameter is also used in the Elizabethan age and the classical age. So we can say, in this poem, the poet want to say that the God and the soul is the same thing, and they are not divided, they cannot be spent, they cannot be damaged, they remains always same, they cannot be spent. So we can say that Alexander Pope wrote a philosophical poem in 16 to 18 lines, and Alexander Pope, who belongs to the classical age, is a great poet in his days, and the technique is couplets in two rhymes. And now the third poem, or actually we can say the fourth poem, because all the wordages stays is read last day, and second, third, and this is the fourth poem of poet's pen. The Charge of the Light Breeze. The Charge of the Light Brigade. This poem is written by Alfred Lord Tennyson, who belonged to the Victorian period. Victorian period is belonged to 1809 to 1899. Actually, the actual date is 1834 to 1890. And this age is belong to Queen Victoria. And behind the name of Queen Victoria, this age is called the Victorian age. According to the poetry, or if we think, according to the poet, this age is also called the Tennyson age. Because Tennyson is the most famous figure in this age. And he was born in 1809 and died in 1892, which is very similar to the reign of Victorian age. He was made poet laureate in 1850. Poet laureate means the national poet of the country of England, and he was made poet laureate in 1850. Before him, Wordsworth is also was made poet laureate. The Charge of the Light Brigade. This is a poem about war, battle, or a situation between two countries, a tension between two countries. The Crimean War was fought by Turkey and Britain against Russia. This is a one sentence. The Crimean War was fought by Turkey and British army fought against the Russia on Crimean War. And it is very famous war because there are few soldiers on one side and there are many soldiers on the Russian side. So they fought like a lion, they fought like a brave man, and they fought because they know that they will not survive in this battle because they are few people against a big army or a big battalion. But although they fight very bravely and take part in the battle on their horses. A fatal mistake forced a small band of soldiers to charge against the much stronger army. Their commander made a big mistake and forces a small band of soldiers to charge against a big army. The march to a stronger army. The Russian army is very much stronger than their own army. There are cannons, and cannons are everywhere. Cannon into right, cannon into left, and cannon into behind and in the front of them. They are around by the enemy's army. So we can say that they are the brave people who take part in a battle, who are very few, and the enemy is in a large number. The soldiers knew that they will never come back. They will never can survive from this battle because the enemies are in a large number. The soldiers fought till almost all of them died on the battle. They fought like a lion and did not surrender themselves to the enemy. This poem shows the duty of a soldier, that a soldier should follow the orders of his commander and he can never ask a question to his soldier. This poem shows the dedication of a soldier to his master or his commander. So we can say Alfred Lord Tennyson write a beautiful poem in just simple rhyme scheme, and the rhyme scheme is league, onward, death, and a hundred bridges. We can say that there is not a regular rhyme scheme, but we can say there is a regular rhythm and regular intervals, and there are 8 lines stanzas in 6 numbers. The theme of the poem is courage of a small group of soldiers who is going to fight the enemy which is in a large number. Technique. In this poem, the poet makes effective use of rhyme in the short lines of awoke and scene of battle. As we can see in the picture, that it is a scene of battle, and the poet makes effective use of rhyme scheme. The rhyme is irregular, but it has an effect on the reader's mind. There are the 3 chapters we have read in last 25 minutes, The Charge of the Light Brigade, and Essay on Man, and Death the Leveler. All these 3 poems belong to some special kind of technique or a special kind of matter. Death the Leveler is a mythological poem which shows that death levels all the men who is a king and farmer. He doesn't partiality to anyone. King and farmer all are same in his eyes. And the second, Essay on Man, shows us a description of men who belong to the great spirit. All the spirits are related to a great spirit. And third shows us, as we saw the picture, the third shows us the duty of a soldier. The duty of a soldier is to carry on the order of the commander. And the poet, the Alfred Lord Tennyson, make effective use of rhyme in the short lines of awoke, the scene of battle. Now, We can say that all these three poems are very simple in the language and very lucid in the fluency. As in the last of the third poem, The Charge of the Light Brigade, there are some important lines in this poem. Cannon to right of them, cannon to the left of them, and cannon behind them. This shows they are covered by the enemy all around. And there is one more line, forward the light brigade. This is the command of a commander to his army, to his brigade. And the soldier have to accept the order, and they fought like a lion to the enemy, and the enemy kill all of them. They are killed one by one, half a league onward. In all in the valley of death rode the 600 soldiers. They are only 600 in numbers, and their commander says that half a league means half a mile, one and a half a mile is afterward. The enemy is waiting for them, and they go forward the light brigade. The light brigade is commanded to go forward. Charge for the guns. The poet said, the commander's voice said that they should charge for the guns. The Russian army has the guns, and the Russian army has cannons and the topches. And the commander said they should fight like lions with the enemy. And at last, this poem shows duty of a soldier. In next class, we are going to read about Wordsworth's famous poem, The Solitary Reaper. The Solitary Reaper is one of the most beautiful poems of Wordsworth, William Wordsworth, who is a romantic poet and who wrote in a lyrical ballads many beautiful poems. William Wordsworth was born in Lake District of Northern England. He is called the poet laureate also, because he is given this chance by the Queen of the England. So in next class, we will finish the two poems. First is from William Wordsworth's Solitary Reaper, and second is Leigh Hunt's poem, Above Ben Adam. Above Ben Adam is a biblical character. So see in next class. Thanks.